The Bible says in over there in Acts 2 that in the last days, old men will have dreams. Well, I guess I've officially passed the bar because I've been having the same dream now for about 3-4 nights in a row. And it's a simple thing and wasn't making a lot of sense, but I was just seeing kind of like the back, there were lights, kind of like you'd see on the back of a taillight of a car. And they were red, green, blue, and white, just lights. And so had the same dream last night and woke up and I said, what does this all mean? And it's really quite simple. The message that we are to proclaim, the message that we are to take to the world is simple. First, it's red. It's the blood of Jesus. And that blood of Jesus brings us salvation. And salvation and its entire package. Okay? It's wonderful. The red stood for the message of salvation. Jesus still saves. We might not have it up there, but churches used to have. Jesus saves. And that is the message. He'll save you from your mess. He'll save you from your bondage. He'll save you from all the bad mistakes you made. He still saves. And he sets us on the right straight. Okay? Blue. Blue stands for healing. He is our healer. He heals our spirit. He heals our soul. He heals our bodies. He heals our families. He'll even heal our society and our land if we will implement his word. He loves us. He not only took away our iniquities, but he took away our diseases and our sicknesses, wherever they are found. Okay? So we got red, salvation. Blue is healing. Green. Green's eternity. It's eternal. It's evergreen. And it is the part of that thing for which Jesus died for us, that we would have eternal life, that we would live forever, that he would make for us a new heaven and a new earth wherein dwells happiness and joy and peace. And we are to tell people that. There's more to life than just what we're living right now. There's a whole eternity to come. Everlasting life to be gained. There's an everlasting life to be lost if we don't embrace Jesus as our Lord and Savior. And then white. White stands for holiness. Without holiness, we will not see God. There are seraphim that surrounds his throne, and you know what they're saying all day long, all night long? Holy, holy, holy. I watched a video on YouTube by Dr. Michael Lake, and he said that when in the Hebrew language you want to emphasize something, you say it more than once. For instance, Jesus, in many times, he came and he said, truly, truly. Okay, well, that is the Hebrew way of putting the exclamation point on something. Truly, truly. And he said, if you want to really say something, you say it 3 times. And he said, there's only 2 times in the Bible when something is said 3 times. One is, God is holy, holy, holy. And the other one is found in the book of Revelation, where it says, woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth for what's coming. We don't want to be here for the woe, woe, woe. Therefore, we want to be holy, holy, holy. Let's go from there. If you got your Bibles, open them up, or you can watch on the screen. We're going to be doing from the King James. We're going to begin with Leviticus chapter 10. And Nadab and Abihu, the sons of Aaron, took either of them his censer and put fire therein and put incense thereon and offered strange fire before the Lord, which he commanded them not. And there went out fire from the Lord and devoured them. and they died before the Lord. And then Moses said unto Aaron, this is it that the Lord spake, saying, I will be sanctified in them that come nigh me. And before all the people, I will be glorified. And Aaron held his peace. Now think about that. Aaron's two sons, anointed to be priests, they take it upon themselves, they're going to do it their way. And they go in, and fire, the same fire that had consumed the burnt offerings when they were dedicated and sanctified, they put all this stuff on the altar, and God sent fire and consumed it right before everybody's eyes. They didn't take a match to it. God just, like on Mount Carmel. And so they're going to do it their way, and they instantaneously died. And I got to thinking about that. We are to be a people that serve a holy God, and we are to be holy. The Ark of the Covenant contained the Ten Commandments, contained Aaron's rod that budded, contained a jar of manna. But it was where the presence of the Lord was, where these two cherubim wings met. That's where God would meet the high priest as he would go before them once a year. And everything in the Old Testament was a picture and a type of what was to come. And so you have the priests, a priestly line that has been sanctified and set apart for the Lord. The high priest, the Aaron of our time, is Jesus. But who are the priests that were to help him, as Aaron's sons were to help? And so if you would turn to 2 Peter, or 1 Peter chapter 2, and it says in verse 9, but ye are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you should show forth the praises of him who hath called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Now you want to be in his marvelous light, and you don't want to be in darkness, because in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, it says the world is in darkness, and it is not even going to know when Jesus comes. But because you are in the light, you will be ready and you will be prepared. Now, I want you to get this. I want you to think of yourself this way. I have been made a priest unto Almighty God. The same Almighty God that made Aaron and his sons priests unto him. God's not changed. He's still holy, holy, holy. The difference is we don't have to kill animals to come before him, because Jesus has been our sacrifice. It says in Isaiah, when you and he make him a sacrifice for you. And the idea there is when the Father and you make Jesus your sacrifice, just as if you sinned in the Old Testament, you had to go get a lamb or a goat or a dove, had to be without blemish, and you brought it to the high priest, and he sacrificed it, and your sins were remitted. They were covered. Well, when God the Father and we made Jesus our Lamb of God, slain from the foundations of the world, who is without sin, who is without blemish. And you know, when they did the Passover, they said, now listen, you do not break any bones in that lamb, not a one, because Jesus was not going to have any of his bones broken. Remember, they broke the bones, the legs of the thieves on each side, not his. Okay? Everything was an example, a picture, and a pattern of what was to come. And he has called you forth, just as he called Aaron, just as he called Abihu, just as he called those high priests and priests, Levites down through the, he's called you forth to be a priest. Does it not say that? Does it not say that you are a priest unto the Lord? You know, they actually tied a rope around the high priest's leg, and on his robe, he had little bells. So they could stand out there and listen when he was in making the sacrifices. And if the bells stopped moving too long, they tugged on the rope, make sure he was still alive, because nobody could go in there to get him out. We're going to pull him out. Holy, holy, holy. Now, you, as a priest, a depository of the Holy Spirit, an entity that God is going to move through to touch people. Do you think it's important that you be holy? You know, a pastor can stand here and beat people over the head with different things. You shouldn't be doing this. You shouldn't be doing that. You shouldn't be watching this. You shouldn't be going there. Apostle Paul deals with that. He said, listen, Jesus has set us free. He's made us free. We're not under bondage and slavery to things. Big controversy over whether you could eat meat that had been sacrificed to idols or not. And he deals with that and says, hey, if it's going to offend your brother, don't eat it, but I got no problem with eating it. Type thing. But let me ask you a question. Should you, as a priest that's going to minister unto the Lord, are there things on TV you shouldn't watch? We've been so desensitized. Stuff, if we'd have seen it in 1955 when I was a kid, it would have been shocking. Amen. Goes right by us right now. We've seen so much of it. Don't think anything about watching adultery, fornication, licentiousness, drunkenness, murder, hate, revenge, all these things that the Bible says have no part of. We just sit there. And we watch it, and it goes in, and it affects us. It affects us. I don't think I'm going to be watching much pro football. I love football. But you got people that won't stand for our flag and the national anthem. When you've got people out there bringing those flags in, dressed in uniforms that could be dead in a few years because they've been sent to Afghanistan, they've been sent to Iraq, or who knows, Korea. Well, we're just making a point. I'm making a point too. One of the things that stands out in my mind that's just kind of emblazoned there, it was the 4th of July, 1969. I was in Anque, South Vietnam, and I was on my way walking down to the PX. It was hot, no clouds, big, tall flagpole with the flag of the United States flying on it. And I looked up at that flag, and in that flag was the embodiment of everything from Bunker Hill to Shiloh to Iwo Jima to Verdun, the Verdun Forest, to Hamburger Hill, and to what I was in the middle of, and it was going on. That flag. That flag represented the blood of the men and the women who had sacrificed themselves for the cause of freedom and liberty. As long as I live, my hand will be over my heart saluting that flag which represents those people. when they carry me out over my casket will be that flag. That flag will be folded by men in the United States Army, maybe a woman. They will hand it to my wife or to my son, whoever, and they say, please accept this from the President of the United States for your husband or your father's service. That flag. That's my flag. And I don't like people burning it. I don't like people spitting on it. You have a right to protest. Leave the flag alone.
Amen. Amen.
Well, anyway, we're priests. Things you shouldn't watch, things you shouldn't do, places you shouldn't go. You belong to Jesus, and the Holy Spirit is in you, and the Holy Spirit will speak to you. Now, here's the thing. I believe revival's coming. I believe it. And it's going to require you to be at your optimum. If you knew you were going to war, they'd be taking... When I was over in South Vietnam, and I did some paperwork for a bird dog outfit. They flew these little airplanes around and did spotters, and they didn't have a clerk, and so they brought it over. I did all for them and never thought anything about it. And so the officer from the unit came over and said, listen, you did all this paperwork. How about I fly you down to Phuket, take you to the officer's club, and buy you a steak dinner? Okay. So we got in this little two-seater airplane, had a canopy on it, pushed it back. It was like riding in a convertible. Right. And even had music. Yeah, and so we get down there, and while we're there, there's this ROK detachment that goes running by, Republic of Korea. And they ran like 2-3 miles every day, did all these cows. And this officer said to me, said, you know, the Vietnamese don't mess with them. I said, no. He said, no. They shoot one of them, they go into the village the next day and take out about 4 or 5 of them, put their heads on a stake. And said, they don't mess with them. And I want you to be in such good spiritual shape. Such good spiritual shape that the enemy has such fear of you that he won't mess with you. And if he messes with you, you turn on him, face him square up, and take the weapons of your warfare and take him down. And I want you to be holy so that the enemy cannot taunt you and say, you are a sinner. You know this sin. You know this thing you watched. You know this thing that you did. You have no right with God. You do have a right with God. You have been made holy by the blood of Jesus. But listen to the Holy Spirit and draw nigh unto God. If you will draw nigh unto God, he will draw nigh unto you. Just a question to you. Do you, on a daily basis, read your Bible? Do you, on a daily basis, pray? I'm not saying you got to spend an hour in prayer. I'm not saying you got to read the Bible for an hour. I mean, we're busy. But do you take time to meditate upon the Lord and draw nigh unto him so he can draw nigh unto you so that you can have faith? Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. It's a wonderful thing to pray, but that's just half the equation. When you pray, believe.
Amen.
You can pray until your knees are worn out. But if you don't believe, I don't think anything much is going to happen. You've got to pray and believe. And believing comes from faith, and faith comes from spending time in God's Word. Holy, you are a priest. You have priestly garments that God has put on you. Keep them clean. It was a big deal before they could even put those garments on. They had to be washed down with water. Any stains on them had to be removed because they were going in to minister to Almighty God, the great I Am, the one we sang about. And then one other scripture. It's found in the book of Revelation, chapter 1, verse 5. And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood, and hath made us kings. See, I'm not a king. It's not what that says. See, this little life that we're living right now, it's nothing in the annals of eternity. And in eternity, we don't know for sure what's coming, other than we will be kings. And if we're going to be kings, we will be presiding over something. Conceivably, even during the millennium, that 1,000-year reign of Jesus, one of us might get to be mayor of Fairton. You never know. You just never know. But he has made us kings. Do you see yourself as a king? Or do you see yourself as a nobody? Do you see what Jesus did for you on the cross as to no avail? Or can you say, actually, in the annals of the history of mankind, I am a VIP. I am a very important person. God has favored me. You say, well, it's not right of God to have favorites. He just favors anybody that will trust him. Psalm 5 says that he has surrounded the righteous with a shield of his favor. I am a king. Then maybe we should conduct ourselves as kings. Maybe we should conduct ourselves as royalty. Everybody's all fascinated by the royals over in England. But you can learn some lessons from them. Number one, they don't send their children to regular schools. They send their children to schools to prepare them to rule and reign. Maybe we should be sending our children to schools where they are being taught how to rule and reign. Where they're being taught how to be holy, 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 because God is holy. Being taught how to not touch the unclean thing. Being taught how to hate that which is evil, to run from that which is despairing and will destroy them and will drag them down and will rob them of their place and their victory in Jesus, because Satan is a liar. And if he can get them to sin, he'll destroy their heart and he'll destroy their mind and tell them they're a nobody and nobody loves them and life is worthless and they might as well take a drug overdose and die. You say, that doesn't really happen. Oh, yeah, it does. Because they're dealing with spirits. Do you understand that there is a kingdom of hell? That there are principalities, powers, spiritual wickedness in high places. And they do have authority and they do have power over people that will give them that power. But not you, because you hate that which is evil. You abhor that which destroys. I always liked MAD myself, MAD. Mothers Against Drunk Drivers. You probably don't get all stirred up over MAD. You probably haven't even thought about MAD. Let me tell you who thinks about MAD. It's the mother of a young girl driving her car down the road, that gets hit head on by a drunk driver and is killed. That's who hates alcohol. That's who hates drugs. Because they know that these are devices that have robbed them of the most precious thing they'll ever own. Mad. We're not mad about anything. We're not mad about the devil stealing, killing, destroying our country. We're not really mad. We don't get all exercised about it. We don't even think enough about it to pray about it for the most part. We don't speak up. We don't take a stand. But we're going to, because we have been made kings and we have a right to exercise authority. And we are holy because the Holy Spirit is going to lead us into that holiness so that the purity of Almighty God will reside and live in us, that when the revival comes, He can use us as instruments to go out into the field. And they shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves.
Yes, hallelujah.
We shall come rejoicing, bringing in the harvest of people who have been crushed, who have been beaten down, whose lives have been molested by the powers of darkness. And as Jesus Christ, under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, flows through you, you lay hands on them. You see those devils come out. You see the victory come into their lives, because we're going to be seeking as individuals and as a body the anointing of God. Send it, Lord. Anoint me, Jesus. Let me be an instrument. Flow through me. I want it, Lord. I want it. Do you want it? Do you want it? I want it. And He has made us kings and what? Priests unto God and His Father. To Him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Behold, He cometh with clouds, and every eye shall see Him, and they also which pierced Him, and all kindreds of the earth shall wail because of Him. Even so. Amen. I want to challenge you. I am a king, I am a priest, and I will live worthy of that calling.